Chapter 23 of Matthew, we're looking at verses 13 through 33. And so what we'll do is I'll begin reading here in Matthew chapter 23 at verse 13. I'll read to verse 22 and we'll get into our study. Matthew chapter 23, verses 13 through 33. So let's begin reading in Matthew 23, verse 13. Jesus says, "But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayers. Therefore, you will receive greater condemnation. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, and when he's won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. Woe to you, blind guides, who say whoever swears by the temple, it is nothing, but whoever swears by the gold of the temple, he's obliged to perform it. Fools and blind, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whoever swears by the altar, it is nothing, but whoever swears by the gift that is on it, he is obliged to perform it. Fools and blind, for which is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? Therefore, he who swears by the altar swears by it and by all things on it. He who swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And he who swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits on it." In chapter 23, Jesus began to preach his final public message. And as we were together last time, we saw that in the first 12 verses, he spoke to the multitudes as well as his disciples. Now, when you look at multitudes, the multitudes speak of the people who are listening to him, but not necessarily saved. I mentioned to you that Jesus' popularity had grown among many people. And we need to remember that not every person who heard him actually was committed to him. Now, there were some who simply appreciated that he was saying what needed to be said, and there are others who simply appreciated the way he spoke and found him attractive. And like it says in Mark 7:37, the common people heard him gladly. And so as is true, whenever the word goes out, there will be those who are hearing it with an ear of faith saying, "I want to know these things so that I can live by them." And then there are others who simply may appreciate what's being said or may have this internal recognition that the things that are being said are valuable to be said. Not necessarily that I'm going to embrace or act on those things, but I do agree with what I'm hearing. There are quite a many people like that that were during the time of Christ as there are the same today. Early in the history of Israel, God spoke concerning these kinds of listeners, the people who say, "I appreciate what you're saying and how you say it." When you look in the Old Testament, there's a prophet by the name of Ezekiel. And in Ezekiel chapter 33, verses 31 and 32, the Lord God is speaking to this prophet, and this is what God says to him. God said to Ezekiel, "They come to you as people do. They sit before you as my people. They hear your words, but they do not do them. For with their mouth, they show much love, but their hearts pursue their own gain. Indeed, you are to them as a very lovely song of one who has a pleasant voice and can play well on an instrument. For they hear your words, but they do not do them." See, there's always been people who appreciate what's being said. They even speak. He says in that same passage, they're speaking about you on the street and on the corners. And they say, "Come and hear the man of God." And then God goes on to say, and they come and they sit before you as people do. And they're acting as if they're my people, but they're not mine because they hear and they do not do. You see, great crowds came. They heard God's word from someone who was faithfully proclaiming it. And even as God is telling Ezekiel, they took pleasure in the voice and the eloquence, the beauty of the words. They enjoyed the delivery, the words that were chosen, the manner in which he was speaking. It's interesting how in Ezekiel 33, verse 32, how it says there that Ezekiel's words were like a very lovely song. And that I find fascinating because when I was preparing the study, I was looking at various translations of that one word, lovely. And I found that the word lovely meant something that I hadn't really noticed. And so I did some research on it just to make sure that what I'm saying to you is correct. And when he says, when God says to them, to him, indeed you are to them as a very lovely song of one who has a pleasant voice, the word lovely there actually has, it can be actually translated by the word sensual. You are a very sensual song, is what God is saying. In other words, that means that it appealed to them as what would be called a lover's song. In other words, it appealed to them on a physical level, but not on the spiritual level. And there are many songs, even to this day, that are called worship songs. And some of you don't, I should say this quickly, because I make assumptions that I am probably wrong in doing. Some of you don't realize that what you know today as contemporary Christian music and what we know today as Maranatha-type music or whatever, contemporary Christian, actually came about through Calvary Chapel Ministries. Maybe you don't know that. Maybe you don't know that. You know the dove that you see everywhere? The dove? That's called the Maranatha dove. Did you know that? The Maranatha dove was actually the trademark for Maranatha music. And that dove right there behind you that you see on all these cars and everything, that came through Calvary Chapel Ministries. You probably don't know that, but it did. And what happened, it was popularized and people started using it. That actually was a symbol for Maranatha music. Maranatha music was the first label that became well known that had Maranatha artists singing Christian contemporary songs. So Calvary Chapel actually introduced to the nation and into the world the worship that you have taken for granted for all of your spiritual life. That was something God used Calvary Chapel. So sometimes I assume everybody knows that history, perhaps you don't, and that's the history. And so I speak of somebody as somebody who was there when it began. I speak as somebody who experienced this firsthand as a 20-year-old young man. And so I know what I'm talking about when I say it, and sometimes people may not know that. I'm not saying that to try and puff myself up. Just to make a point, you see, to make a point. So we grew up with what was called contemporary Christian. It wasn't even called that. It was just called Christian music. And we would listen to songs that were written from the Psalms. We actually took the Psalms and put it to music. So the original songs that you would hear were actually verses. We called them praise songs. And they were verses that you found from Scripture. And we would sing Scripture songs. That's what it was. There were no such things as Dove Awards and number one Christian song, none of that. That's all the world creeping in. That's the world coming in and saying, oh, God likes this song more than that one because more people bought it. But that's not how it was. And so I'm saying all of that to say this, that when we began, you know, we were looked at as radicals because we actually had drums on the stage. We actually had electric guitars and I've said this recently, but it is true. The people were saying at that time, they were writing against Calvary Ministries and against Pastor Chuck, and they were saying they're bringing in voodoo music into the church. And to this day, there are people who still say that about us. They're still saying that kind of thing about us. But here's the thing. When it first began, when we began to bring in the music and all of that, they were praise songs that were just done in contemporary style in terms of the music we were listening to. But they were scripture verses that we would use that were put to music, and the people were learning to memorize scripture through that. And it's changed over the last several years so that many times, and this is not a complaint, it's an observation, it's not a criticism so much as saying be careful, it has changed that the songs that at one time were about worship. Now, let me tell you something about the word worship, worthyship. That's where the worthship, that's where the word worship comes from in English, worthship. It speaks of intimacy. And when you speak of worship, you're not speaking just of singing a song. The literal connotation is an intimacy with God that has actually been pictured as a love that God has for you. That is a very deep spiritual love. Why am I saying that? Because when God is speaking to Ezekiel, he says, You're like somebody who sings a sensual song. It appeals to the physical, but it is not changing them in their hearts. They come and they sit before you like you're a rock star, like you're a performer. They're enjoying your concert, but they are not kissing my face in worship. They are not worshiping me. They sit before you as my people. They come as people do, and they sit before you as if they're my people, but they are not my people, for they hear and they do not do. And that's what the Lord is saying here. And so when he's speaking concerning that, he's saying these great crowds have come. They've heard the word from somebody who has faithfully declared it, and they take pleasure in that voice, the eloquence, the beauty. They love the words that are spoken. You're like a lovely song to them. It's appealing. But it appeals on a physical level, not on a spiritual level. Someone said this, Ezekiel's voice and the music of it were appreciated, but not the substance of the message. They appreciated how the song message was presented, but they did not pay as much attention to its content as they did to how the message was given. They enjoyed the harmony of his voice, the eloquence of his speech, the clearness of words and the dynamic power of his presentation. What they did not do is obey what was said. They were not open to the teaching and the preaching of the message, and were no more moved by his speech to repent from their sins any more than had they simply spent an evening in a concert. That's what was taking place when Ezekiel was proclaiming this message. And somebody else said, the gospel is a lovely song indeed. It reveals the love of God and the love of Jesus. Often the voice of a gospel minister is a pleasant voice to those who understand it. But to others, it is a voice and nothing else. They may be delighted with his performance, but not with his subject matter, for they hear the words, but they do not obey them. And one of the things that I, as a pastor and as a minister of the gospel, as somebody who's walked with the Lord for a good portion of my life, one of the things I get concerned about is that I see that that is common today in many church gatherings, where it is more of a value in terms of how it makes me feel rather than how it transforms me to be. The gospel is to transform us on the inside. And so Jesus is speaking here in Matthew, and he's sharing some things to those who are listening. Notice that the multitudes need to become disciples, or they're going to remain lost. You see, as Jesus was teaching, his message centered on the danger of false teachers, and he was specifically confronting their hypocrisy. He was warning against them. Last time we were together, we looked at verses 2-7, I referred to five qualities of a false teacher, and I pointed out that they possess selfish ambition, they lack integrity, they lack compassion, they desire attention from man, and they lack humility. When we looked at verses 8-12, I listed five traits of a genuine teacher. They do not yearn for special recognition. Jesus alone is their teacher, and their allegiance is to him. They answer to God and not only to an earthly organization or system. They are not above others, but are members of the body of Christ, and they are content to simply and humbly serve the Lord and others. So as we arrive now at verse 13, Jesus is directing his comments to, notice, the scribes and the Pharisees, and he's condemning the religious hypocrisy of the scribes and Pharisees. He has spoken to them as being hypocrites. These were the people who were only acting righteous, but were not righteous from within. The word hypocrite is a Greek word that was used to refer to actors. You had masks, comedy and tragedy, and the actor would put on a mask, and he would play that part. And that's what is being spoken of here when he speaks of hypocrites, when he speaks of hypocrisies. And it's interesting to note that he saves his most scathing rebuke for those who were in religious authority. From verses 13-29, Jesus refers to them as hypocrites seven times. Somebody once said, of all things in the world that stink in the nostrils of men, hypocrisy is the worst. And he's pronouncing them under God's harshest judgment. Now, eight times he pronounces woes on them. When he begins, he says it very clearly. He says in verse 13, "Woe to you." Now, to me, this is kind of interesting. The word woe, where did we get that from? The word woe. All of us know the Hebrew word for woe. We just don't realize it. Perhaps we don't realize it. The word in Hebrew is oy. Oy. So who here has ever heard the term oy vey? You know, well, oy is the word. That's the word that's translated for us by the single English word woe. It's a passionate cry of sorrow, grief, despair, or dismay. And that's what he's having right now. So he's saying, woe unto you. So one, he says, you're hypocrites. Two, he pronounces a woe. And three, he actually calls them names. Now, think about that for a moment. Sweet Jesus, you know, carrying a little lamb with kind of a smile in his face. That doesn't register with some people. But he does. He does that here in chapter 23. Listen to the flattering way in which he speaks to them. He says, you're hypocrites. You're sons of hell. You are blind guides. You are fools and blind. You are whitewashed tombs. You are serpents. You are a brood of vipers. Love you. See you next week. You know, I mean, what a scathing rebuke that he's bringing on these. And yet, he speaks in this way for a purpose. You know, there are those today who would say, man, Jesus was a hater. No, he did hate. He hated sin, and he hated what happened to those who were in bondage to it. Somebody also says, well, does this not violate his own command to love others? I mean, today we live in what we used to call it this. We used to call it sloppy agape, you know, where you just basically just make excuses for everybody's sin. You know, oh, don't judge them. Don't judge me. You know, there are guys today, I see it, you know, sometimes I see it on an MMA fighter. You have a tat and he'll say, only God can judge me, as if that's something he ought to take pleasure in. You got to think about that one for a minute. Yeah, God will judge you. You don't have a relationship with Christ. But the bottom line is that we have a lot of people who don't have discernment at all or the capacity to say, I love you enough to tell you the truth. And when Jesus was speaking, he was speaking the truth. You see, those who think that Jesus is violating his own command to love others simply aren't reading the Bible. They don't realize that in the Old Testament as well as the New, God very often would speak concerning the unfaithful shepherds, and he would bring warnings to them. Ezekiel, again, in Ezekiel 34, verses 2 through 6, said, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds, the leaders of Israel. Give them this message from the sovereign Lord. Destruction is certain for you shepherds who feed yourselves instead of your flocks. Shouldn't shepherds feed their sheep? You drink the milk, wear the wool, butcher the best animals, but you let your flocks starve. You have not taken care of the weak. You've not tended the sick or bound up the broken bones. You have not gone looking for those who have wandered away and are lost. Instead, you have ruled them with force and cruelty. So my sheep have been scattered without a shepherd. They are easy prey for any wild animal. They have wandered through the mountains and hills, across the face of the earth, yet no one has gone to search for them. In Jeremiah chapter 12, verse 10, many shepherds will ruin my vineyard and trample down my field. They will turn my pleasant field into a desolate wasteland. You see, throughout the history of redemption, the greatest threat to God's truth and God's work has been false prophets and teachers because they proposed to speak in his name. That is why the Lord's most scathing denunciations were reserved for the false teachers of Israel who claimed to speak and act for God, but were liars. And that's what Jesus is speaking about here in this passage, guys. These men were truly hypocrites. They lived for the honor and praise of people, but they didn't love them. And so he begins to speak to them and pronounce woes. Notice verse 13. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. You are excluding men from God's kingdom, as you yourselves also are. What you're doing is you're rejecting Jesus and you're influencing others to do the same. You see, true Christians influence people into the kingdom and not away from the kingdom. And there are people who, in the name of God, turn people away from God. And that's what Jesus is speaking about here. You shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. There was a knock on the door at my house. I opened the door. The two people standing at the door, "Hello, we'd like to talk to you about the kingdom of God." And I say, "Well, wonderful, come on in." And they sit down. And as they're speaking, they're seated in my front room on the couch. And one begins to speak. And they're representatives of the Jehovah's Witness organization. And one begins to speak. So I ask a question of them. And the person next to her says, "I'll answer that." So I turn to the person next to her and I say, "But I didn't ask you. I asked her. I'd like her to answer if you don't mind." And I said, "So," and I asked the question again. She goes, "Well," and then she turns and looks at this person next to her, and so the person next to her begins to want to answer again. Some of you may or may not know this, but when Jehovah's Witnesses go door to door, what they have is a mentor and the person being mentored. And so the person being mentored is allowed to share, and then when a difficult question comes up, then the one mentoring is the one responsible to give the answer, because in that way, they're teaching them how to respond to questions that are being asked by people like myself. And I'm aware of that. And so I turn to this woman again, the second woman, and I say to her again, "Excuse me, I'm not speaking to you. I was asking her, what do you think about this?" And then I ask a question, and once again, the other one interrupts. And I say to the other one, "I'm really not speaking to you." I said, "You see, I have to tell you something. Maybe you don't realize this. This is my house. And if I ask somebody a question, I'd appreciate hearing the answer from them." "Well, we can't." And now she's getting agitated. And so I said to the young woman being mentored, I said to her, "Is that the kind of religion you want to be part of? A religious faith that does not allow you to speak for yourself? A religious faith that gives to you replies that you parrot without even thinking about? Because what you are being is brainwashed, and you are being brainwashed by someone who doesn't know the truth themselves. And thus, I warn you, flee from this. Get right with Jesus Christ so you can have eternal life. Because as long as you stay with this woman here in her organization, you are lost." And somebody says, "Oh, how harsh." No, that's what Jesus is speaking about. That's what he's saying. You're not going in yourself and you're hindering those who would. That's what he's speaking about. We see that in our modern day today where people are not entering in, but they are keeping others from going in also. So he says that's hypocrisy. A second thing found in verse 14, he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. Therefore, you will receive greater condemnation." You devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. You fatten yourself off of lonely, generous women. They may have convinced widows to trust them to manage their funds and then defrauded them. Others say that they could have been acting as spiritual advisors. And when the widow would say, "Could you please pray for me?" the more money you gave, the longer the prayer would be. So if you give me $50, I'll pray for 10 minutes. You give me $100, I'll pray for, a half hour. You give me $500, I'll pray all day for you. It was that kind of thing. It was paying for praying. And he says, this is wrong. This is hypocrisy. Somebody said they pray for as they pray on them and enrich themselves. Does this happen today? Is it possible to send somebody some money so they will pray for you? Absolutely. I was watching, this was a while back now, I was watching a particular quote-unquote Christian television program where the evangelist was saying, if you send me some money, we will send, God will answer. When you sow into our ministry, God will answer. And he said, it's like a watermelon. If you take a watermelon seed and you plant it, it says, he said, it produces a watermelon with many seeds. So if you plant a seed in this ministry, God will give to you watermelon seed blessings. And people still do that to this day. And Jesus is saying, you are taking advantage of the most weak individuals in your society. You are using them in that way. And he says, you receive a greater condemnation because you're taking advantage of the most vulnerable people in our society, and therefore you will receive greater judgment. In verse 15, he goes on, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, one convert, and when he's won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. You have incredible zeal, but you are useless in God's kingdom. You aggressively evangelize, but into a worse hypocrisy than you possess yourself. Instead of setting them free, he says, you are ensnaring them into deeper bondage. And this again is the fruit of many cults. They tirelessly travel to share a tainted and ineffective message. We need to remember as Christians, and this sounds again so simplistic, but it's absolutely true. We need to remember that it's the gospel that sets the spiritual captive free. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Romans 1:16, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. He said in 1 Corinthians 1:18, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. He said in verse 15, you know, you make them twice the child of hell as you yourself are. They're doubly damned because of you. They become like you, and they end up lost. Woe unto you. In verse 16, he goes on and says, woe to you, blind guides, who say, whoever swears by the temple, it's nothing. Whoever swears by the gold of the temple, he's obliged to perform it. Fools and blind. For which is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whoever swears by the altar, it's nothing. Whoever swears by the gift that is on it, he's obliged to perform it. Fools and blind. For which is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? Therefore, he who swears by the altar swears by it and by all things on it. He who swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And he who swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits on it. So he refers to the practice of solemnizing oaths through the temple altar and even heaven. And this is what he's saying. He's saying, you have made the physical, which was money and the animals for offering, you have made the physical more binding than the spiritual. And what that does is it displaces the integrity of the one making the vow with the material value of gold. You see, when you made an oath, the oath was made to God, and they were to be kept as a matter of faith as well as integrity. It's like what it says in Numbers 30, verse 2. When a man makes a vow to the Lord or takes an oath to obligate himself by a pledge, he must not break his word, but must do everything he said. Or Ecclesiastes 5, verses 4 and 5. When you make a vow to God, do not delay in fulfilling it. He has no pleasure in fools. Fulfill your vow. It is better not to vow than to make a vow and not fulfill it. So he's speaking concerning the displacing of the spiritual with material and not valuing the one you're making the vow to. Then he says in verse 23 and 24, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. Blind guides who strain out a gnat and you swallow a camel. I have a couple of friends that I see generally on a monthly basis. One's name is Bill and the other's name is Bobby. Bill and I go back Well, actually, we were in kindergarten together. It's hard to believe 20 years have passed. We were in kindergarten together, and I met Bobby when we were freshmen in high school. So I've known these guys most of my life. And long story made short, Bill got right with the Lord after having walked away from God for many years. And Bill and I and Bobby will meet generally monthly, and they live in Orange County, and they'll drive out here. I'll set apart some time for them, and Bill will bring 2 pages. Normally, they're 2 pages worth of questions. And he will ask me questions for an hour and a half to 2 hours, one question after another. I've been mentoring him for several years now, once a month. And he'll bring the question here, and he'll bring the question there, and we spend some time, then we get some lunch. We always go to the same place to eat lunch, and so we were there just this last Thursday. And when we went in, we were seated, and we were wrapping up, and it was time for us to leave, when somebody came walking in and was standing at the cash register, and apparently we're having a pickup for some food to go. And I was seated facing the cash register, and I noticed that this lady turned and looked in our direction. And I thought that she must be noticing how ugly Bill and Bobby are. So, and it's a good thing she was getting food to go, because she couldn't have sat and looked at them and eaten without getting real sick. But anyway, as she was doing that, she looked another time, and I noticed. And so she turns and she says, "Hi, Pastor David. Hi, how are you?" And I said, "Well, I'm fine." And she comes to our fellowship and she says, "May I pay for your lunch?" And I said, "No, no, I already talked him into it, you know." So Bill was paying. I said, "No, no, it's okay. Thank you for the offer. I really appreciate that." And my friend Bill says, "You know, I've already taken care of it." And she says, "No, I insist." And it was very sweet. She kept, "No, I really," and we kept on saying, "No, no, thank you so much for your generosity." And then I said to her, I said, "These are my friends, Bill and Bobby." She says, "Oh, I've heard their names mentioned in church." And I said, "Yeah, these are my friends." And Bill says, "And you've heard this story of how I vomited on David's face." He says, "I'm the one who did it." Like he's proud of that. Like he's proud. Because when we were 16 years old, we went to Wong's Market on Front Street in Norwalk, and we stole 6 bottles of wine. And we downed them, got very drunk, and we were arrested. We were put in the Norwalk Sheriff's Substation there in Norwalk, and I was so drunk I couldn't move. And I was laying on the floor with my face directly looking at Bill as Bill was on a bench. Yeah, and Bill started to vomit. And I was saying, "Stop it, Bill." And he's going, "I can't." And a police officer, a sheriff, saw this taking place. And I still remember hearing him say, "Guys, you gotta see this." And here they come. Ah. So Bill has to say, "I'm the guy who barfed on his face." Yeah, he's so proud of that, right? I hate him. So they're my friends and all. Well, years ago, when I was 20, Bill had started going to a church called Calvary Chapel. And he started inviting me to go. You all know the story. I'll make it brief. I didn't want to go. I didn't want to go. It was the summer of 1970. "I don't want to go to your church." He was so insistent to get him off my back, I go. And I smoked some pot. I drank some beer. I was barefoot. I was a hippie. I expected to be kicked out. I walked in. It was a small chapel that was built to hold about 300. There were people on the platform area, all around the steps. They were through the aisles. There were kids. They were all around my age. And I walked in there and I sat down in that area. And I sensed something that I'd never sensed before. And I had been raised in a religious system. I had gone to church. I was the one who used to make my mom go to church. My mom didn't want to go to church. I would say to my mom, take me to church when I was 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old. I still have memories of sitting in a church pew with my body pressed against my mother and my head on her shoulder, because that was the only place I felt safe. It's the only place I felt safe, in the house of God. I don't know why, but that's a fact. I felt, I'm in the house of God. I wasn't saved, but I remember that it was just a secure place for me, but there was no spiritual. It was just like a safe place. And when I walked into this other little place and the atmosphere was different, I didn't know what it was that I was experiencing. I didn't know what it was. And I've shared this recently with you, perhaps more than once. I didn't know until I got saved what it was. And what it was for the first time in my life in a church, anywhere really, I felt love. I experienced that this is, there are hundreds of people here, but there's something different. It was the love of God. Listen, when Jesus says you are so scrupulous and so, you even go so far as to tithe on your garden herbs, but you have forgotten the weightier things, the matters of the law that matter, the justice, the mercy, the faith. It's not that they shouldn't be givers. Of course, all believers ought to be givers. That's not what he's saying. These are things that you do. You don't leave the other things undone. But the problem is you have been emphasizing what's on the outside and not on what is on the inside. You are blind guides. You strain out a gnat, you swallow a camel. You're so scrupulous in the things of faith, but have forgotten to love people. You're Pharisees. The word Pharisee means separated one. You don't know about justice because you're unjust. You don't know about mercy because you don't show it. You don't know any of these things. You're not living by these things. You're not walking in faith. You're walking by the law. You don't see that the law is pointing to a Messiah. And what you do is you strain things out. When they would drink, very often they would put some kind of filter over the cup, and because there were gnats that would fall into their drink, and so they would, some of them would actually put a little filter, a cloth over it, and drink through the cloth just to strain out the potential for them to swallow a gnat, because according to the law in Leviticus 11:23, it says all other flying insects that have four legs you are to regard as unclean. And so they would sometimes strain it out. Sometimes they would actually wear these kinds of a mask over their face so that they would not, swallow a flying insect. He says, you're so scrupulous about that, but you swallow camels. You strain out the small things, but you indulge yourselves in the worst things. You're so careful about the things that are on the outside, and you don't care about the things that are on the inside. Notice what he says in verse 25, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You cleanse the outside of the cup and dish. Inside they are full of extortion and self-indulgence, blind Pharisee. First cleanse the inside of the cup and dish, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly, but inside are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you're full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. You take that cup, and on the outside you look at it and it appears clean, but when you look inside of it, it's filled with evil. My dad had a ritual when I grew up, and that was on the weekend when he was not working, he would stay in bed, and my mom would make some coffee, and especially Sunday, my mom would make him coffee, and then she would bring him his cup of coffee, and they had the newspaper, and they'd read the newspaper in the room, and my dad would drink his coffee. That was his ritual for many years. And when I grew to be a certain age, my dad said to me, "Son, would you get me my coffee?" And I was like, "Wow, this is really an important thing, bringing dad his coffee." Because to me it was like, wow. So mom said, "This is how your dad takes his coffee." And I said, "Great." So I went in and I got his cup. He had a special cup that he had. My dad was in the Navy, and so he had a cup he had brought from the Navy. It was his special coffee cup. And I put coffee in it, and then I fixed it the way my mom said. And then I carried it like it was a holy chalice of some sort, you know. And I still remember carrying it to make sure I didn't spill a drop of this coffee. And I gave it to my dad, and I'm waiting for his approval. I'm waiting for my dad to take his drink and say, "Oh, son, this is the best thing about waking up. It's Folgers in my cup. I'm expecting something, you know." And he drinks it, and he spits it out. "What did you give me?" And he hands me the cup. Well, my mom, the night before, had taken, you know, a dishcloth or something, and had put all of the coffee grounds and stuff in it, wrapped it up, and had put it in the cup. I didn't check the inside, so I just poured. Yeah. It looked clean. It looked clean. It looked clean, but it wasn't. And that's what Jesus is saying. You look clean on the outside, and people will see you from the outside, because man judges according to outer appearance, right? So if you're a believer, definitely you've never had a tattoo in your life, ever. You don't have piercings. Believers don't have piercings, right? Because Jesus didn't have piercings, and we're like Jesus. And Jesus had real short hair and a kind of real trim beard, you know. I mean, we take the 21st century and we throw it on Jesus in the first century, and we say, that's what Christians looked like back then, but that's not true. I felt more comfortable as a Christian as a hippie. He wore sandals. So did I. He had long hair. So did I. I'm like him. I mean, if you get caught up with that, that's where you're going to end up. The outside, right? The outer appearance. The outer appearance. He says, no, you Pharisees are perfect at looking good, but your hearts aren't. Your hearts are not good. Your hearts are evil. And that's what he's saying. He says, cleanse, verse 25, cleanse the outside of the cup and dish. But the problem is, inside you're full of extortion and self-indulgence. And then he says in verse 26, cleanse the inside of the cup, that the outside may be clean also. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs. During this time of the season, the tombs, when you came into Jerusalem, would be whitewashed, because this is the Passover. Many pilgrims would be entering in. So they cleaned the outside tombs. So when you would go in, they were all whitewashed. But he says, on the outside, they're whitewashed. On the inside, they're filled with corruption. They're filled with the things that ought not to be there, dead men's bones and all matter of decay. That was really a word of warning, by the way, for the pilgrims who were in Jerusalem, to be aware that these Pharisees that they looked up so much to were spiritually contaminating any who came into contact with them. You see, in Numbers 19, verse 16, it says, anyone out in the open, who touches someone who has been killed with a sword or someone who has died a natural death, anyone who touches a human bone or a grave will be unclean for 7 days. Jesus is basically saying to those who are admiring Pharisees, you know, in reality, if you are connected with them, you're unclean. Stay away from their doctrine and their lifestyle. And then finally, he says in verses 29 through 33, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you build the tombs of the prophets and adorn the monuments of the righteous and say, if we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. Therefore, you are witnesses against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of your father's guilt. And then he closes this portion by saying, serpents, brood of vipers, how can you escape the condemnation of hell? All of your outward appearance has not affected the heart. All of your religiosity, all of your external religious righteousness has not changed your heart. You know, God's word teaches us that he will write his law upon the tablets of our hearts so that from the inside we will live out that which he has done. God promises by the power of his Spirit and his word to create a new people who will be known for the works of righteousness that are performed. It isn't by works of righteousness which we've done. It's according to his mercy that he saves us by the washing of regeneration, the renewing of the Holy Spirit. So it isn't because we've done good works, but we do good works because we've been saved. These religious leaders whom Jesus is saying are hypocrites, actors, have made the outer appearance the most important thing. That's why we need to be careful as believers today that we don't make instant judgments on people who may not look like we think a Christian ought to look. Man judges on the outer, but God looks at the heart. And what God wants to do is transform us from the heart. But you know what? Even in our tradition, even we who are Calvary Chapels who ought to be aware of that, it's just part of who we are as a people. Even so, we still have people who get caught up with the outer appearance. I still remember a young man who approached me years ago now, many years ago now, here in this fellowship, a younger man. My hair, some of you weren't with us then. My hair was down to the middle of my back. I mean, I had hair that was all the way down to about right here. That's how long my hair was. You guys may not know that, don't care, but I'll tell you anyway. I had real long hair. I just got tired of cutting it, is what happened. So I had long hair, you know, here when I would pastor. And my hair is real thick, and so it would take me 40 minutes to dry it. And I finally got tired of that. I said, that's pretty much a waste of my time. So that's when I started cutting my hair. But this young man approached me and said to me how happy he was that I had cut my hair, because apparently he thought that when I had long hair, I wasn't as anointed as when I have short hair. You know that, and you know, I didn't get mad at him or anything like that. I just thought, what an interesting observation to make, that we have moved, and this is over 20 years ago, we have moved back to that rigid, self-righteous, it's the appearance that tells me whether they're saved. God help us all. God help us all. You know, you're not going to see me with any piercings. You know, I'm not one who can do that. I can't even get shots. I'm not into piercings. You know, you're not going to see that with me, but I'm certainly not condemning those who do. I look at them and I say, I bet that hurt. Oh, I bet that hurt. I wouldn't do that. I bet that hurt. And the tattoos and all of that stuff. If people want tattoos, I've told you this 1,000 times. You know, they have those little tattoos on their back. Those ladies sometimes will have that little tattoo and all of that. I've told you this. They like that tattoo on their back. A little hummingbird. How cute, right? It grows into a vulture, then what? Then what are you going to do? And you're walking and it's... How cute. I'll say that to Marie sometimes. Somebody will walk by and they've got kind of an outlandish look to them, and I'll turn around and go, how cute, how cute. You know, there you go. You know, whatever, you know. Man looks at the outer appearance, God looks at the heart. Jesus was teaching the Pharisees something the church needs to know and to remember always, and that is very simply this: God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that the only way for us to have eternal life is through Jesus Christ. And there are people who refuse to come to Christ. When they refuse to come to Jesus, they are basically signing their own eternal judgment. And Jesus is making it very clear when he said in verse 33, how can you escape the condemnation of hell? If you reject the one who can rescue you, you are left to your own efforts. You are left to yourself. God loved us enough to send his Son to rescue us, but you want to save yourself, you can't. And because you're caught up with the outer, you haven't had an inner transformation that comes through the power of the Spirit and by the Word of God, through the grace of God. When you've received Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're left in your self-righteousness, and being left in your self-righteousness has left you condemned to eternal fire. That's what Jesus, the most precious, loving Savior, ever said. He said it. You cannot escape the condemnation of hell because you refuse the one who can save you from it. God help us to not refuse what has been offered to us by him.